Howdy ho, Earthmates! I'm CJ.
And I'm Randy, and it's a beautiful morning here in the neighborhood.
That's right, it sure is. It's October the 27th, 2015. It's 10:03 a.m., one of my favorite numbers, 10:03. And, well, we're here coming to you, Yahweh, Love Live, to honor, bring honor and glory to our Father in heaven, standing beneath the veil of the one true Son, first fruit that He gave for us as our deliverer, as our safe refuge. Who is that mystery man? None other than Yeshua of Nazareth, Christ Jesus.
Sounds great.
It does. Oh, it does. Thank you. I sound great. Wow, you're telling me I sound great.
Yes.
Wow, thank you. Yes. Oh, you said it. Wait, okay, I can still take that, right?
But it is you speaking on the radio.
Oh. So I just heard a helicopter go over. That was nice. So, you know, it makes you know
we
that
got
there's
buzzed,
other life.
Huh?
There's other life out there. Life
we got
forms.
Buzzed.
Well, you know, it's a path, I guess. Yeah, we got buzzed.
Well, CJ,
there's a whole different meaning.
I'm loving the music that we're playing this week.
Me too.
You know, this what was Celebration Recovery and the Battle of the Bands has been going on. It's just
the whole the organization is called Celebrate Recovery. I believe it's a .org.
Yeah.
And it's an international ministry. They do things all over the place. And the guy told us, this was so incredible. We were so blessed to get connected up. They said on their first day of on-air broadcasting, they had, I don't remember if he told us, 6,000, 60,000, 600,000, or 6 million. But it was a ton of listeners that they had tap in.
Yeah.
And I thought, wow.
Yep.
You know, that was just an incredible thing. I think it was one of the larger numbers, but I don't want to, you know, boast it or
just a bunch.
Quote it.
And they've had an effect. I mean,
an effect.
Yeah.
And we can see why, because what they're doing is it's a program. It's a ministry program where they try to help us restore our lives.
Right.
And recover from whatever our aches, pains, or hang-ups have been. So whether you've had any kind of abuse in your life, bad relationships, you just have a negative image of yourself, whatever your thing is, whatever your hang-up has been, whatever your hurt has been.
Hang-up on Christianity.
Yeah, you know what? A hang-up on Christianity, for sure. And also people who really never even, you know, who thought that was just a bunch of corny, old-fashioned stuff.
Yeah.
And it didn't catch the hip new wave of time marching on. But you have to look at the behind the scenes. Who caused time and who causes time to march on? And who is the referee, umpire, judge at the end of all time is the one who established the rules of this game of life. And He loves God, like He told you to tell. God loves you. And like He told me to tell. You tell what He told me to tell.
Me tell what you were told to tell?
Yeah, I just told what you were told
well,
to tell.
To come out of her.
Well, yeah, but do you remember the first two steps? It's like that Celebrate Recovery. It was a 12-step program. And do you remember what the three steps of God's...
Love your God Almighty and
oh, no, you're
love
talking about
each
Bible.
Other.
You're talking about the Bible. Okay, let me tell my own thing.
Okay.
It was God said to tell you guys. He said, tell them I am calling. Tell them to seek me and tell them to come out of her. He also gave instructions. He said, first, you will teach them about me. Second, return their happy spirit. Teach them to sing, dance, and praise. Third, teach everything else. And so the thing is, these Celebrate Recovery programs are being hosted by churches all around and different organizations, I suppose. And then these concerts are being put on in churches, and each band has to have, I can't remember if it's one or two members of the band, have to have gone through the Celebrate Recovery program. And the idea is that they would write music from their heart. They would write original music to, you know, share with the world their recovery or
right.
their experience and the answer to it. We understood at this particular one, there was more, you know, there was.
They made an exception on this particular Battle of Bands.
And so it kind of reminded Randy and I of an event we hosted here in Corsicana at Temple Bethel several years back in 2012, I think. And if it wasn't 2012, it was 2012. It was in February, on the 25th day of February, 2012. And we hosted an all-original praise and worship music festival. We met some of the coolest people there, some of our dearest friends, and got to see extreme talent. And people like Sherry Bouse and Sherry McGraw and their, I think they call it the Spirit Riders Worship Team or something like that. And they may have gone through a few changes along the way, but maybe not also. It's still the same group of wonderful people. And here's that helicopter again, checking things out. Hello, I want to go outside and wave. We don't get a lot of action out in the country, so we get excited when airplanes go across.
Well, you know, because of the flood and everything,
they're checking the scene,
yeah.
Probably photographing. And I'm really hoping we can get some assistance with repairing our road, making it passable again. For as it is now,
if you guys are interested, go to CJ Randy Randolph on YouTube and check it out. We put a video on there of our little excursion through our property where the rain had affected, the 20 inches of rain that we got.
Yeah, Sherry Bouse asked me to post that YouTube that you made. She had commented on something that I posted last night, and I asked her if she saw the one that you posted on YouTube, and she said no. She asked me to post it on Facebook, so I said I would. I didn't, you know, the fact that it was past tense and has been there before, you know, a couple of days ago, she didn't see it. Like with us, things stream through quickly. And I'm sure she has so many contacts
as
well.
Well, we had a few people look at it.
Well, we did. And so the thing is, just because we put it up there once, it doesn't mean people, you know, maybe that little pocket of people.
They weren't seeing it at that point.
Yeah, because everyone has lots of action going through their streamline.
What I found interesting is that Thurston, all the way over into South Africa,
he saw it
just within, I don't know, a very short time after I posted it.
Yeah, but you know, that was a blessing because they happened to be staying at somebody's beach house there, and where they had internet connection, because apparently in Africa you can go long distances and have no internet connection.
No connection whatsoever.
So in a way, that's kind of a blessing.
Yeah.
And in a way, then you get behind on knowing what's going on makes you tune in more and more to the Spirit and let the Lord be your guide. So anyway, it sounds like they're having a wonderful time. And speaking of Thurston, I mean, this is a connection. Today is Eddie Rogers' birthday.
Hey, happy birthday, Eddie. We love you.
I know, so happy birthday.
And miss you.
Yeah, happy birthday, Eddie Rogers, and happy birthday everyone out there who's celebrating birthday.
You know, Eddie Rogers has a website that's called Torah
Truth.
Truth. And thank you, CJ. Uh-huh. And he has all kinds of wonderful things on there that I highly recommend, that if you're wanting a closer walk and a closer study, go to Torah Truth. .org, I bet. I don't know if it's .com or .org, but try either one and go and check it out, because I promise you, he will unveil some things that you had never thought about.
You know, you would think it might be a .org, like you might think Two Faithful Beach Bums would be a .org.
Yeah.
But it's a .com, even though it has nothing to do with a money-making venture. But nonetheless, it just is what it is. And, you know, here's the thing. I was wanting to say about some of the other people we met initially at the Temple Bethel original music worship festival. And we met Melodious Lady. Now, some of these people we met there, and some of these people we just got to attest again to their extreme talent. But so I said Sherry Bouse, Sherry McGraw, they have other members of their team, and I'm so sorry that I don't recall everyone's names. It's not leaping to the forefront of my mind right now. Cynthia Willis.
Right. Now Buckmeyer.
Now Buckmeyer. And, you know, she's so infectious. She's just so, you know, so filled with the with the joy of right. being alive. And then melodious lady performed, you know, another extreme talent and a dedicated person. But there were so many, and while I maybe don't remember everybody's name, there's this one performance that sticks out in my mind that I thought was just over the top. And you know, the one that just grabbed my heart, mind, and soul, I don't even remember the lady's name, but she played the piano and she had written several songs. And when she sang, the tone, the heart behind it, the passion, I guess is what it was, for the Lord and her walk with Him, it was like you know, remember that song called Magic Carpet Ride?
Mm-hmm.
Who sang that, by the way?
Steppenwolf.
Well, her song sounded nothing like Magic Carpet Ride, but literally it took me on a magical, mystical carpet ride into the heart of God. It was just so endearing. And I would just love to see her again and just, you know, give her a big hug and tell her how touched and blessed we were that she performed. And I would like to record some of her music to play here on the air to see if it has that effect. Because we've played Melodious Lady, Sherry Bouse and Sherry McGraw, Cynthia and Norris Buckmeyer. We've played, you know, the Tents of Witness. We've played lots of their music. And then all these other wonderful people also. But I would really love to find a way to trace that lady back and get some music from her.
Yep, that would be great.
You know who she reminded me of? Janie from the other night. Janie that had been the winner of a former Celebrate Recovery.
Janie Marie.
She was a solo artist, and she wasn't competing at this Celebrate Recovery. She was there acting as one of the judges, and of the competition, and she had won one of the former Celebrate Recoveries, and a very powerful voice. To me, she kind of reminded me of a mixture of Carole King, Janis Joplin, and Nora Jones.
There you go.
Yeah, it was powerful. So you're heading somewhere. Where are you going next?
Well, CJ, all the things that we've been talking about this morning, the Lord put this on my heart because of two things that are occurring. And I'm going to give the two titles, and then I want to talk about both of them. One of them is, the headline is that Netanyahu is going to divide Jerusalem. Okay?
No.
All right. So that's one thing.
So he's agreed to it. This has something then to do with the false peace plan that's going to allow the rebuilding.
Yeah, I want to talk about that in a second.
I'm sorry. It's like for me, it's
the title.
It's a math problem.
The other thing I wanted to talk about was the lukewarm.
Oh, that's an important topic.
So I want to give you the option. Do you want to talk about Netanyahu in that situation, or you want to talk about lukewarm?
Are you talking about first and second?
Yeah, because they both are going to end up in the ultimate reasoning behind all of this.
I think we should look at the current event first and then apply it to the biblically.
All right. First off, the deal with...
And thank you for asking me. I feel blessed that I got to help choose the direction. Thank you.
There's a map that I wanted you to see, and I thought maybe we could post it, but I couldn't get it done quick enough. So this is really for mine and your benefit.
Okay.
And then we'll kind of like, if you want to scoot over here a second.
You know, I am so quick at this, truly. I can take a map before you have.
Turn the sound off. If you're going to unplug it, it'll blast.
I'm not going to unplug it.
All right. Well, I have a map of the Israel and the borderline areas with Jordan and Syria and Lebanon. That, if you remember, folks, not too long ago, I think it was Thursday or Friday, Where we were talking about that demilitarized zone that they call the Golan Heights area, and we were talking about Mount Hermon and the Ascension area, not Ascension, Transfiguration, I'm sorry, the Transfiguration area of Yeshua, Jesus Christ. Well, this area that CJ's fixing to show a picture of, this is the area that is in question of dividing up and making it a Palestinian state, okay? And I want everybody to understand what we got going on here, because this is the Valley of Jehoshaphat. And you go, what is the Valley of Jehoshaphat?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So the reason why I as soon as CJ posts this, and it's a clear, wonderful picture, and it'll give a full understanding of what's happening now and what the Bible says about this very area, the Valley of Jehoshaphat.
Valley of Jehoshaphat. That's the title of this,
right? Yeah, yes. Okay. Now, I'm going to, as she's getting this photograph prepared and to go onto Facebook, this is what Benjamin Netanyahu is quoted as saying, and this is from the virtualjerusalem.com. If you want to go check it out and look at their headlines. The prime minister was quoted as telling the cabinet residents of Arab neighborhoods should be stripped of Israeli permanent residence. CJ?
I'm listening.
This was failed. It says failed.
Okay, well then we'll just forget it for now.
Alright, I'm going to read that again.
Alright.
Prime Minister was quoted as telling cabinet residents of Arab neighborhoods that should be stripped of Israeli permanent resident status. Do you understand what that means?
Well, tell us what you've already thought of, and fill us in on what it means.
Why would they strip them of permanent Israeli residence?
Well, so they can give the land to someone else?
Yes.
Or so it can be like that other section of space that is a no occupancy zone.
It is the beginning of the change. First, they got to strip them of their personal Israeli status, meaning that they have revoked their Israel ties. Then, the area that they're living will end up being the new state. You can't have both. In other words, you can't have being an Israeli countryman and then be in another country. They're saying, we're going to strip you of your status, and then whenever this area ends up becoming the state of Palestine, now you're clear and free to go. That is the beginning of how this works. Okay. So that people that understand both sides of the coin know that this has to happen first. And here is Netanyahu making this statement, okay?
Right. So you can kind of, what you're seeing is handwriting on the wall.
Yes.
Not necessarily that they spoke those words, but you see what's coming.
All right, here's his next comment. We cannot continue with the present situation outside the fence and suggest that taking away the blue identity cards from the residents be considered. The Arabs in the eastern part of Jerusalem are issued blue ID cards to be similar to the ones carried by citizens and enjoy permanent resident status. So what they're saying is that once this happens, those cards are going to be taken away from them, and they will not be able to travel into the other parts of Jerusalem because of this. Okay?
Right.
So they're covering all their bases of all the things that has to happen before the declaration of the Palestinian state. All right. Another thing was ministers who were, okay, this is another comment. Ministers who were surprised by Netanyahu's statement noted that such a move would have dramatic diplomatic ramifications. Since 1967 have vowed not to redivide Jerusalem after its unification in the Six-Day War, taking away the permanent resident status of Eastern Jerusalem Arabs could be interpreted as the first step towards undoing the annexation of Eastern Jerusalem and the application of the Israeli sovereignty there. Okay?
Okay.
So, these are the indicators that's a handwriting on the wall of the movement towards relinquishing that state.
Wow.
Okay.
Well, that doesn't sound good to me. Because
all right.
God says, don't divide the land.
Exactly. Now,
and
what?
It's already been divided in other times.
Now, what you just said is my next, and I'm so glad that you, this has everything to do with the valley where all nations shall be gathered by Jehovah for judgment.
And who's Jehovah? Is one more way of saying Yahweh.
Yes. All right. So that is in Joel 3.
Okay.
And that's,
that map is on there now.
Oh, thank you.
You're welcome.
Joel 3. And I'm gonna read Joel 3 first. Two through 12, so that we can kind of get a feel of what's going on here.
All right, Joel 3, two through 12. Right.
I will also gather all nations and bring them down to the valley of Jehoshaphat, and I will enter into judgment with them there on account of my people, my heritage Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations. They have also divided up my land. They have cast lots for my people, have given a boy as payment for harlot, has sold a girl for wine that they may drink. Indeed, what have you to do with me, O Tyre and Sidon, and all of the coast of Phoenicia? Will you retaliate against me? But if you retaliate against me, swiftly and speedily I will return your retaliation upon your own head. Because you have taken my silver and my gold, and have carried into your temples my prized possessions, also the people of Judah and the people of Jerusalem, you have sold to the Greeks, that you may remove them far from their borders. Behold, I will raise them out of the place to which you have sold them, and will return your retaliation upon your own head. I will sell your sons and your daughters into the hands of the people of Judah, and they will sell them to the Sabines, to a people far off, for the Lord has spoken. Proclaim this among nations, prepare for war. Wake up the mighty men, let all the men of war draw near, and let them come up. Beat your plowshares into swords, and your pruning hooks into spears. Let the weak say, I am strong. Assemble and come, all you nations, and gather together all around, because you're mighty ones to go down there, O Lord. Let the nations be awakened and come up to the valley of Jehoshaphat, for there I will set to judge all the surrounding nations. CJ, they just hit on the headlines. This part where it says, the temple, my prized possessions. They just uncovered a warrior's tomb in Greece. It was a Greek warrior, and it was a tomb of some mighty warrior. And it was they had untold treasures in it. And it was been buried for over 3,500 years.
Wow.
So, just not sure knowing what the history is behind it and who he was and where
right.
he came from, reading this note, you have sold to the Greeks.
Mm. Oh, wow.
It just hit the headlines today.
Well, that's something to follow up on, but it's you can quickly see the likelihood of a connection.
Yep. And then all of this stuff about the Valley of Jehoshaphat. Now, I gave you that map.
Yeah.
Okay. And I want you to see on the map that everybody's looking at on our Facebook account. That's C.J. Randolph, R-A-N-D-O-L-P-H. The map says Megiddo. Okay. Well,
Megiddo.
Or Megiddo, Megiddo. Megiddo.
You say Megiddo, yeah. I say
well,
Megiddo.
I want you to look at this.
Where we're both wrong.
at the top of it, it says Golan Heights. You have Lebanon and Syria, Golan Heights. Well, right now, in that area, that's where the oil situation is, where they found the new oil fields up there. And then now you have Syria in that Lebanon areas where all the military activity is occurring with the Russians, the Chinese, the United States and France and Syria and the rebels and ISIS. That area right there in that Golan, just outside that area. And
here's the picture.
Well, great.
See that it's there.
Thank you. So.
So they can look at, people following on Facebook can see a picture of what Randy's describing right now.
Yep.
So you don't have to just try to blindly say, what is he talking about?
This area that says Golan Heights is a disputed area where it says Golan.
Oh, I spelled Jehoshaphat wrong. Oh, well.
Okay.
Use your imagination.
The Golan Heights area is the disputed area, and where it says West Bank mm-hmm. is the disputed area. Mm-hmm. That whole area is the Jehoshaphat area.
Okay.
Okay. And this is where the Armageddon, the War of Armageddon.
Uh-huh.
Now, I'm not saying we're being set up for the War of Armageddon, because you see, that's for the final judgment. That is the Armageddon is down where the 1,000-year rule has occurred, and then there's this great battle between Yeshua and Hasatan that's going to occur after the 1,000-year rule.
Right.
Want everybody to understand that these things that are occurring right now has to take place first. So that West Bank area is the disputed area that they're wanting to turn into a Palestinian state.
Right.
And you see where Jerusalem's at. So they're going to divide Jerusalem and have the western part be the Palestinian area where it says West Bank, okay? And then the eastern part is where it says Israel is the part that's going to end up staying Israel.
Which is to say they're being nice to a... Can you be nice to a fault? This becomes the question. Can you be nice to a fault? Like God, the Father, that gave this all the territory that's already been cut down, given it, who he gave it to Israel as an inheritance for the 12 tribes for an eternal possession, never to get rid of, has been cut so many times. And now the very heartthrob of Yahweh as possession here, Jerusalem itself being divvied up between Palestine and Israel. And so you have to ask yourself, you know, what, I mean, it's not, nothing takes God by surprise, but it's that thing, you know, where you're instructed, don't do a thing. So a disappointment, can we be nice to a fault that we care more about human feelings than God? But the thing is, I don't guess it in the long term sense, it's all already established what will be. And so all we're doing is tracking the steps of prophecy and what will happen.
Yes.
And so it's really, it's all God loves Israel. God loves, period. But he, even in his word, he lets us know that, I suppose it would be the Palestinians or the Arabs, however you would look at that, the ones who don't determine to come and trust Yahweh, the Lord, the great I am, and be veiled with the veil of his own son, that God gives them their inheritance on this earth, which diminishes or takes away any opportunity into the future. You know, I just remember while I was reading the Bible, he tells those people, you will get your reward on earth. You know, he's going to allow them to have successes.
Right.
And they're going to be so like filled up with joy. But then when it comes down to the extreme latter moment, it will be a grand disappointment.
Amen.
And all right. So, yeah, it all goes together.
Well, we're fixing to get into what you're just talking about. Okay, so I'm going to read scripture here.
Oh, wow, cool.
All right, so what this is Revelation 3:16. Now, I find this very interesting. Who wrote the book of Revelation?
Well, John.
All right, who wrote
John? Not John the Baptist, but John the disciple.
Right, now right. John, okay, John wrote Revelation 3:16. He also wrote another famous 3:16. John 3:16.
Well, then isn't that what you just said?
Well, yeah. Well, Revelation 3:16.
Oh, okay. Well, okay. I thought John's name was in there twice. So, all right. So you're saying Revelation 3:16 is also a famous verse, as everyone knows, John the Gospel 3:16.
Yes.
Now the question is, what is John?
No, Revelation.
Yeah, what is 3:16?
Mm-hmm. So then, because you are lukewarm, and neither cold nor hot, I will vomit you out of my mouth.
No one wants that.
Okay. So that being
said, if nothing makes you shudder more than that, and start thinking about your walk with the Lord,
what is he talking about? What is he talking about? Lukewarm versus hot and cold.
Well, it would be willing to stand with the truth and what God's will and desire is, or will you cater to what make all the shiny, happy people shiny and happy?
Oh,
so will you? What will you do? Will you stand with God, with Yah, with Yah? With the great I am?
Right.
Or will you pretend like you don't notice?
Right. Well, you're so good. You're like...
No, there is one good.
I know. Isn't that great?
But thank you. That was a very sweet thing to say.
All right. Well, I have some... I did a little bit of commentary study on this, and I got a couple of things that I want to bring forward. But what would you consider that... attitude, what we just talked about, with what Netanyahu is doing to appease the Palestinians? What would you call that? Would that be lukewarm? Would that be cold? Or would that be hot?
What Netanyahu is doing?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think he knows the Bible well enough, not just the Tanakh, but he knows I believe he knows all.
Right.
That he knows that it's one of the breaths and steps that must be taken. And so...
So you're thinking he's overlooking that?
I think he has friends in different places that share the story with him.
Okay.
If he doesn't know it personally, but I believe he does.
Okay. I love your comment, because you see... some people would take that as a stance that he's a traitor.
Yeah, I think he just recognizes what's going on here.
Okay, that's very good and very astute. And I think everybody needs to understand that some people would consider it self-fulfilling prophecy, mm-hmm. that they're stepping into that. But when you realize that it's inevitable, you understand really who's in control.
Oh, yeah, it's trusting God. Now, God instructed his people, don't do these things.
Right.
So then the choice has to be made. Am I going to be the one who does these things?
Yes.
Or am I going to continue to trust
Which
Yahweh?
Means he has prayed on it so much that he knows.
And he could have received counsel through dream or spoken word. We don't know. It doesn't have to come through a human source.
Well, the first thing that came out of your mouth is, you've got to be kidding. Oh, no.
Yeah.
But then as we discussed this and as we unveiled the understanding here, all of a sudden God is revealing himself and saying,
Yes, come on.
Okay, isn't that beautiful?
It is beautiful.
Okay,
it's beautiful also that you would recognize God unveiling things.
Yeah, here's the next thing I want to do. Where do you think Palestine would be? in regards the Palestinians, where would they be in regards to the lukewarm versus the hot or cold?
Well, apparently, it seems to me that the Palestinians have very little lukewarmish. They're very gung-ho on what they do. And I'm not just giving that to the Palestinians, but that Arab mindset. But then you ask yourself, where does that come from? Is that a positive energy or a negative energy? What's the driving force? And I think the driving force behind that is unaddressed anger and animosity and unforgiveness. They have a bitter root in their heart about what happened in the past, perhaps. Not my judgment, but observation.
CJ, What did God do to Pharaoh?
He did the worst thing that you could.
He hardened his heart.
Yeah, he hardened his heart.
Against Israel.
Yeah, he did. Oh, that's a great point, Randy. Talk about a beautiful line. Yeah, so it's not really simply their own, but how can a person's heart be hardened whose heart isn't already filled with rubble and debris?
Exactly.
Unreleased.
Exactly. Animosity. Cold against God.
Cold against, I don't know if it's against God, but it's definitely cold against man. It's where, like Yeshua said, you know, it's like the Lord's Prayer. Father, please forgive me my trespasses as I forgive those who trespass against me. So the Arab are, and it's to put everybody in one clump is so wrong. I don't know what else to say. I don't want to just say Muslim, but perhaps that's what I should say. But that mentality of Esau and what's the line?
Ishmael.
Ishmael and all those folks that felt rejected and, you know, betrayed and all that kind of stuff. And it's one of those things that we all have hurts and hang-ups.
Yeah.
And there's some bitter roots, and we have to let God pluck them out, or they will be our destruction.
Yeah. Isn't that great, though, how that unfolds and how that you look at that, who would be lukewarm, who would be hot, and who would be cold?
Yeah.
And we got to realize who's saying this.
Right.
We got to understand.
Right. The great I am.
Yes.
The Lord himself is saying this.
Against him, lukewarm against him, or
exactly.
Hot with him,
right.
Or cold against him. We have to realize who's saying that.
Exactly. And everyone has a role to fulfill.
Yes.
And God can make good of all things for who? For those who love him. It's really so massive. The thing is, this just like God saying, you must know the Bible.
Yes.
And that's the starting line.
Well, CJ, the reason why I brought this up, and as we get on, I got more things to bring forward on this. We have to understand that there is an illusion.
Ooh.
Okay. The reason why we have to understand both sides of the coin, along with God's viewpoint,
right,
is to be able to see past that illusion of where you were having trouble. You were sitting there going,
it's so massive.
Yeah,
there's so many layers.
Yeah, and see, God has allowed you and I as a team.
Right.
Is that I can see the forest. Mm-hmm. Okay. But then you can see the trees,
right?
And the combination of the two coming together does an unveiling that it's God,
right?
Okay,
right.
So I'm going to go on to the next level, keeping that illusion aspect in mind, because I'm trying to help people understand to look beyond what you see specifically about the tree. I'm trying to get everybody to see the fullness of the forest. And God's viewpoint of what's going on.
Yeah, and we're thankful that God allows us to see through his eyes. Not, I mean, it's like when Ezekiel in chapter 1, it talks about the four living beings, or the winged beings, and they're on what I would visualize as sort of like a unicycle with an extra rim inside that's filled with eyes,
right,
looking to and fro in all directions. It's sort of like the peoples of the earth and the believers, those who walk with the Lord, those eyes are many seeing, and God sees through God uses our eyes to put our faces towards those things He wants you to see.
Yeah.
And so He's turning the wheels.
Yes, He is.
In the many directions and causing those who walk with Him to see. So in no way are we trying to say we have the only eyes. We have two sets of eyes that God is focusing on these things. And it's a beautiful trusting walk with God, and to see the things that He's doing, and to be, you know, to be blessed,
yes,
by that, as we also see the things that other people share that God causes them to look upon, as we
Look outside of the norm, to look outside of the box that tradition has established on them.
Yeah, like what Randy's doing here, taking the scripture, taking the current event, and taking the revelation by the Holy Spirit, what God is causing him to see or to be aware of.
Yes.
I love it.
So one of the commentaries, and by the way, this was on Bible Hub, and on when you type in a Bible verse, they have at the bottom of the section commentaries.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, Bible.
So this was on Revelation. Revelation 3:16. Okay.
All right.
So I went in and I wrote some commentaries. So I'm going to kind of read this, but I put in my words to make it a little bit
sweet.
Okay. This is a question. How many people are neither hot or cold, except as they're indifferent in needful matters, and hot and fiery in disputes about things of lesser.
Exactly.
You know?
Mm-hmm. That's a great point. I like that. And it's so obvious. I mean, that's the thing, and why God would say no strife and things like that. The body must unite in that which is really important. There was a day and a time when, yeah, the Bible says, come and let us reason together. But in these days, I mean, we can't negate that. And in these days, the things we must reason upon are those things that truly are critical.
Yes.
Now.
Well, what you just said, I say, this is what Randy says.
Okay.
If you,
so did you just read a line that they said?
Yes.
And now you're going to give us the Randyism to
Yes.
It? All right.
You see, it's an abomination to not be hot.
Yeah, it's a terrible danger.
Or to be lukewarm or cold. It's an abomination. Okay?
Well, he says better that you were hot or cold than that you be lukewarm. So the only one that's an abomination is lukewarm. That when the judgment comes, it will be a clear-cut understanding, like when he rightly divides things.
Yes.
You were either hot for the right things or cold for the right reasons, but don't be just standing there trying to be in the safe zone of make everybody happy.
All right. Thank you. Good point.
Thank you.
Now, here's my next one. This is a commentary. People would give a false opinion of Christianity as if it were an unholy religion, while others would conclude it would afford no real satisfaction. Otherwise, its professors would not have been heartless in it, or so ready to seek pleasure or happiness from the world. I'll read it again. People would give...
Now, what came just before that? Maybe I need a little more information. Like, what's that paragraph just above that one line?
How many people are in either hot or cold?
Okay. In needful matters.
Right.
And hot and fiery in disputes about things of lesser moment.
Right.
it's an abomination. A severe punishment.
That's my comment.
Is threatened. Oh, okay.
That's my comment.
Oh, okay. So I should leave that out for this moment. How many people are neither hot nor cold, except as they are indifferent in needful matters, and hot and fiery in disputes about things of lesser moment? People would give a false opinion of Christianity as if it were an unholy religion, while others would conclude it could afford no real satisfaction Otherwise, its professors would not have been heartless in it, or so ready to seek pleasure or happiness from the world. That's the extreme of hot and cold.
Yes.
And I think that part, professors would have been heartless, probably refers back to the Christian Crusades.
Yes.
And so are so ready to just deny it and go for this dark world pleasure of lustful and whatever all the world has to offer.
Exactly. And the reason why I wanted to bring this mm-hmm. in, the way that you read it is uh-huh. exactly what it was intended for.
Uh-huh.
But I want to ask you, the Vatican,
mm-hmm.
the things that's going on with them, would they be considered hot, lukewarm, or cold?
I would say that from their own impression, they are probably hot in their own mind, but it would be that they are exceedingly lukewarm to what the Lord Himself taught.
The next statement is my statement. One cause of this indifference of what you just talked about and inconsistency in religion is self-conceit and self-delusion.
Yeah, that's so those two tie together, and that was well said. And you take me by surprise, the vocabulary you use when you write versus what you use when you speak. And that's what, you know, so it's really cool to hear you where you've thought behind the scene and write down, because you're usually a person of very few words. And so, yeah, that's awesome, man.
Okay. Thank you. So what's important here is that we got to understand what the Vatican is doing and what the Vatican is playing. I mean, as far as you're saying lukewarm,
mm-hmm.
exactly. That is the dividing the word of what we've been talking about, of
right.
how they represent themselves. So you have the Palestinians who are one way.
Right.
This Palestinians who are one way, who are about to get their way.
Mm-hmm.
And the way that they've been doing is through violence.
Right. And they're and again, it's like it says in Scripture over and over, God will cause a people to rise up against. Why would He do that? Why would God cause a people to rise up against His own? Because of lukewarmness, and He forces you into making a hot or cold decision. What's in your own heart is, you know, what's the reality
yeah.
within your own heart.
So you see the world siding with Palestine.
Well,
okay.
You see much of the world, but you also see others taking their stance. You see the true church. You see a remnant coming out of her and being willing to not be a people pleaser, but to truly want to be in line with God, and God first, mankind second, but it all ties together in
it
love.
It does.
Yeah, and so it doesn't make one perfectly right, because God, He sees it all, and He knows where the missteps are. And He knows what your heart is attempting. He knows if it's in order or out of order.
Right.
And so thank you, Father God, for being that tiebreaker. Thank you, Lord Yeshua, for the judgments that come in the dividing of right
Amen.
And wrong.
Well, one of the most important things that we have to realize is by being able to establish that concreteness that we're talking about, the hot.
Right.
And within ourselves, it's so important for us to stand up and be accounted for during this time. All right, I'm going to go back to the reading of the commentary, because this is going to kind of pull things together as I go along here for this whole thing.
Okay, and hey, before you leave that exact thing, in my Bible where it makes, you know, connections, on that one verse that you have, 3:16 out of Revelation, that read, "So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth." It references here to 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 through 8, and it labels it as apostasy.
Right.
So the thing is, when you start looking at it in that way, apostasy, what does it mean? Apostasy is where you turn away from the true faith towards some lesser, some concocted.
Right. You know,
and that's
most people
what's happening.
Yeah, most people would say, okay, I'm still going to church on Sunday. I'm still doing these things that the Pope says and my preacher says. I'm still doing these things. How could I be in this great apostasy?
Well, and no longer really do I have a comfort in speaking just about what the Pope is doing as the general church separated out, because what we see is that the churches are some, many perhaps, are making haste towards being in agreement with that. And while the body is to be unified, is to be unified in truth.
Right.
And to be unified in love, and not to tear each other down, but to continue to encourage one another towards truth. Because one thing we don't want to be is the axe wielder or welder, the sword carrier that says, oh, you know, cut you out and cut this out. But we ourselves then turn our face, just simply turn your face to the Lord, encourage everyone to, like what's going on here.
Yes.
Speak the truth, speak it in love. Don't make, we don't want to create a hard line between ourselves and other believers, even the Catholic Christians, but to make a, and I'm not trying to be lukewarm here, but to make a straight, hard line connection between ourselves and the very Lord God Almighty, our Father in heaven, and the Son that He gave for us to lead us home. In anything short of that, even what the Pope says and does, if it is out of order with what God Himself says, then we have no choice but to step away from that,
right,
to keep our eyes on the Lord.
Amen.
It's not to step away from our brothers and sisters. Our goal is to continue to encourage everyone until the light shines.
That's
aha.
Right.
And it's not to say we stand perfectly in that. We are having aha moments over and over.
Yes, we are.
And
are you going to read 1 Timothy?
Do you mind?
No.
It's actually 2 Timothy.
Oh, sorry.
It was 2 Timothy chapter 3. So thank you for giving me that moment. 2 Timothy chapter 3 verses 1 through 8 regarding the apostasy predicted. And here we go. And it says, listen to this. The believer's resource, Schofield, says is the believer's resource? The scriptures. As the holy scriptures, where do we turn to make sure we're in right order? And didn't God speak to this himself? God said you must know the Bible, and there's only one way to know it, and that's to read it. And from cover to cover, from the beginning until, you know, the Lord Jesus comes. So here it is, chapter 3, 2 Timothy, verses 1 through 8. This know also, that in the late days perilous times shall come, for men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers. A truce is like making a peace agreement.
Yep.
Truce breakers, blasphemers, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the power of, from such turn away. So there's an instruction given here. where people have a form of godliness, but they deny the denying the power thereof. From such turn away, for of this sort are they which creep into houses and lead captive silly women laden with sins, led away with diverse lusts, ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Now as Janes and Jambres withstood Moses, so do these also resist the truth. Men of corrupt minds, reprobate concerning the faith, but they shall proceed no further, for their folly shall be manifest unto all men, as theirs also was. And so the thing is, it's telling us what we're going to be seeing, and are we not seeing these very kinds of things? And to each of us who believe, we must like self-check daily, really breath by breath and thought by thought, like the Bible says, take every thought captive.
Captive, yes.
And so when, if you capture, if you take note of a dark thought or a, you know, downcast, downtrodden mind, a given upness, you know that that's not God. And you have just slipped back into the human realm, the worldly realm, and have looked away from the one who makes all things right. And thank you, Father God, that Jesus, that our beloved Yeshua, did not do that.
Amen.
But when the going got tough, he he was faithful unto the very end.
Yes, he was. And, CJ, thank you for reading
welcome.
That.
And thank you for giving me this space.
And I think it gives everybody another layer of where we stand.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, I want to go back to reading. This is commentary that's on Bible Hub on Revelation 3:16. What is the difference between their thoughts of themselves and the thoughts Christ had of us?
Mm-hmm.
What would be the difference? They're saying, okay, first, whenever you think about where you're at, whether if you're lukewarm, whether if you're hot or cold, think about it through God's eyes.
Mm-hmm.
Not through your own, whether if you're hot or cold.
Then let me ask a question. What, and this is, first off, this is just common knowledge. I mean, this would be just biblical knowledge. But what did Yeshua, Christ Jesus, instruct those who wanted to walk with him to do? What did he tell them they must be willing to do?
Well, there was a lot of things, but the first thing that came to my mind, he said there was two very important commandments that he felt that were the most important, and that is to love our God with all our heart and to love one another.
And thank you for sharing that. That's important. And that, you know, sort of like that's the bottom line. But what did, I want to ask again, let me restate it. What guideline did Yeshua of Nazareth lay down to those? What did he tell them they personally must be willing to do in order to walk with him?
To die for your friend is the best thing that you could do. And so for dying for him, die it within yourself and let him take over.
Yeah. And another one is, he said you must, he said that he has nowhere to lay his head, that you must be willing to sell everything and walk with him. So the question then becomes, if we in our hearts and minds truly believe that we are in the latter days, and the difference between a multitude of people standing firm in truth, for it says there will be a great falling away, for a body of people, a remnant of people, to stand true to the Lord until the bitter end, then we must be willing and knowing in this day. Otherwise, we would appear, if we know that that we must be out walking and talking and sharing truth, as is happening right here, teaching truth, then if we're unwilling, if we're afraid to speak truth, if we're thinking, you know, well, you know, what will happen if I speak that? Will my friends still want to be my friends? Will this happen or will that happen? That's an act of fear. And God tells us to be strong and courageous. Like you mentioned, to love one another, to love God first. The only way to love God is to love His truth. And since God gave us into the hand of Yeshua to walk with Him, that He would be the one who would lead us home, we must really be willing to step outside the configuration of what we might think is safe and equitable in keeping with the ways of the world. We must be willing to step out on the limb and take a chance on if it will break or not, and trust that God will catch us and hold us strong and steady until our testimony be fully given. And that for what reason is to honor the Father, to honor our Lord, our Deliverer, Ransom Payer, Redeemer, the very Son of God, who is our commanding officer in this day, the one leading us home, to walk with Him fearlessly in love, speaking things. Not, we're not out here yelling and screaming, saying vile, rude things about anyone. We ourselves are saved by grace, and we're so blessed and thankful for that, learning day by day. Thank you. And and just being willing to lay everything down and walk with the Lord. So there becomes a question, though, when you're out and about in your day-to-day affairs and God puts an opportunity in our path, do we hurry past it, or do we recognize that we are walking with the Deliverer? We have been ourselves delivered and truly die to self, and be willing to, like, not worry what this one thinks or that one thinks, even the one at our own hand, but to do what would the Lord have us to speak, say, or do, not thinking, well, I shouldn't do this now because I might embarrass that person. Well, what about the Lord? Are we becoming a blight in His eye, a lukewarm witness, or are we so committed to task, mm-hmm, that it's okay even if you get fired from your relationships?
Sure.
That's the thing.
Well, CJ, I know where you're coming from, but there's another part that it's not just the absolute of understanding, like if you're in a situation that you have to make a decision, whether if it be a righteous decision or an unrighteous decision, if somebody's needing your help one way or the other, or if God's leading you to, like the Lord put it heavy on my heart for us to go over and pray for that young man at the Battle of the Bands. Okay?
Yeah, and that was very
I could have refused that. But mm-hmm, Here's another thing to think about. What if you're in the middle of worshiping? Uh-huh. What if you're in the middle of praising, and all of a sudden, while you're doing that, other thoughts start to come into your mind?
Yeah, it's part of the battlefield.
You're robbing the Father.
Yeah, absolutely.
So what ends up happening is that it creates an environment of uncertainty, which causes confusion.
It could even be considered lukewarm.
Yes, while you're in the middle of that moment,
right,
all of a sudden you're not hot for the Lord, you're
cold. You have cares for the world.
Yeah, your right. cold is going with something else.
Right.
Okay.
Well, you know, regarding the praying for the person, sometimes that's the beauty or the joy of walking two by two, is that it can also be this frustration of walking two by two, but it's also can be the beauty, is like the lead you had from the Holy Spirit that we should go pray for one of the individuals at the Celebrate Recovery Battle of the Bands, and it was in the middle of someone else's song, and you were telling me to come go with you and let's do this, and I was feeling uncomfortable myself to go talk to someone during someone else's worship, and I just kind of blew your request off. I just kind of ignored it, because you felt such a compelling urge toward it, you spoke again and you said, come on,
they did
we
finish
need
the
to
song,
do this.
And while they were introducing the new song, we went over there. And but so, anyway, okay.
And so that's all right. Go ahead and continue on.
Okay. I'm sorry.
It's all right.
Okay.
Remember, it's part of the beauty and part of the frustration, walking two by two.
Okay. All right. So here's the next comment that's made on this commentary. Now, I just read the part, what is the difference between their thoughts of themselves and the thoughts that Christ had of them? Okay. Then there's this next comment. How careful should we not cheat our own souls? So that's kind of what we're talking about here, is that we allow these things invade into us that takes us out of that spiritual realm, and we're cheating ourselves. Mm-hmm. We're not just cheating God, we're cheating ourselves when we do this.
Absolutely.
And it's so important that
well, what was the word? Cheating ourselves of what? How did they word it?
Our own souls.
Yeah. Cheating our own soul. What can your soul be cheated of? I will ask you, Randy. What can your soul be cheated of?
The ministering to the Heavenly Father. That's what he's looking for, that one-on-one relationship where you're ministering to him.
Yeah, I think that's part of it. I think there's another part too. How do you cheat your soul? Is because once you are in the heavenlies, what we would see from the scripture, once we are gathered up, which once we die to self, we are in the heavenlies. The idea is to be there daily, point in and point out, constant. The doing it is a whole different scene, which is an indicator of not being fully dead to self. The coming and going, like blowing of wind and stuff like that. But the cheating of your soul would be in the rewards that would be in the heavenlies. You have cheated your soul by not fully operating in the opportunities that were set before you.
Right.
So you are cheating both the Father in the worship that he deserves.
Yes.
And you're cheating your own soul of the reward that was intended for you.
Amen. Thank you, CJ. All right, I got this one last thing that I'm going to read that's a commentary, and then I have a word about that commentary. A lukewarm believer is one that serves God and mammon. Mm-hmm. Now, there was a big question for me about mammon. So I went and looked up what mammon was supposed to
cool.
be.
What'd you find?
Okay, in the New Testament, it's considered greed or material wealth.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Okay.
And I got this from Wikipedia.
Okay.
It also says Middle Ages was also often personified as a deity. That mammon was a deity.
Right, something that you serve, right?
Okay, so
gold and silver and trinkets. And
it says
stuff.
Included in the seven princes of hell.
Ooh.
So really, mammon is considered a son of Hasatan.
And when we say mammon, it's talking about monies or material wealths of some sort. Primarily,
well, that's
think
why
of it
I
as
greed.
Right.
Okay, so greed could be anything, whether if it be attention, mm-hmm. whether if it be not wanting to help somebody,
mm-hmm.
because my time is more important than yours.
Where I'm going is more greater importance than.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's not just a material wealth. It's mm-hmm. it's looking at my time is more valuable
mm-hmm.
than yours.
Right.
Even driving down the freeway and people cut you off and trying to say, okay, I've got to get there before you do.
Right. And even the road rage that might, then that whole retaliation mentality.
Yeah.
It's both.
Okay.
So just because you get cut off, let it go.
Yeah.
Let it go.
So that's real important to understand the concrete aspect of mm-hmm. wealth
mm-hmm.
isn't just mammon. Okay. It is what you do with greed, and it could be the concrete aspect of wealth, but it is also what you do with your spiritual awareness and how you handle life's lessons and blessings.
Yeah, I don't see a problem with expanding it.
Yeah.
I know that their focus was, because in other ways they speak to those things, but since we don't have those other passages sitting there before us, I don't see there's an issue with expanding the message or the meaning, because we know it's scriptural anyway.
Yeah.
And but that whole thing, seven princes of hell, kind of got my attention. I see it's highlightable.
Yeah, it's a link in
Wikipedia.
Wikipedia. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Not sure I really want to visit it.
Nope.
But you know,
if anybody chooses to do so, they can go to mm-hmm. and check it out.
Right. I'd rather know the seven princes of heaven. Or the one prince of heaven.
Well, there are 24 elders.
Well, there are.
So, I mean, there are princes in their own right.
Maybe. Okay. I don't know. They're called elders for a reason. So
okay.
I'm not really stretching. I'm not going with that.
The whole point of all of this mm-hmm. is...
Oh, there are the seven spirits of God.
Yeah.
So that would be... There you go. There are seven spirits of God.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So the whole point of all of this is knowing where you stand with God and Yeshua, Jesus Christ, where you stand with your family, with your city, your state, your country, the world. Where do you stand? Because I can wrap it up in this one Bible verse in Matthew.
You got my attention. Wrap it up.
No one can serve two masters. He will either hate one and love the other, are to be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon.
And with that statement, then really comes the, well, how you expanded greed to relationship or something like that. It really comes into that, because if a friend's eyes are on their friend, wanting to be friendly and wanting to maintain relationships at the cost of ignoring what the Holy Spirit is leading you to understand. It's not to say that the Holy Spirit's not going to lead them, because God calls you to be hot or cold. Everyone's assignment is different. Maybe my assignment is to cause someone else to stretch in a way. It doesn't widen the walkway. What it does is it widens the battlefield, or it turns up the heat of causing you to stay true to God and what He has poured inside of you. Stay true to the call that is in your heart. Stay true to what Scripture says. Stay true to the Lord and to His holy truth.
Amen.
And so everyone's role is different. What may stretch you about my walk may equally be known that another person's walk be stretching me. And so it goes back to that thing the Lord said. He said, keep your eyes on me. Don't look left or right. So He doesn't want us to get caught up into those things. And because we walk as two or one, however, it's just easiest to use our own relationship, and then everybody can just kind of equate it to your own relationship. If my focus is if I find it of greater importance to keep you happy than to keep the Lord happy, or to keep you happy with me or me happy with you, if that's my focus,
yeah,
because it's an ebb and flow. If that's a greater call in my heart and a constancy of in my mind, rather than making God pleased,
right,
then choices are probably not being made correctly.
Correct.
And what would happen if we're really walking with another of faith and our mission is the same, then when we serve God, it should ultimately be endearing to the other. And if it's not, if it doesn't cause the other one to walk with us but to walk away from us, then that's God's own dividing.
Yep.
And so, you know, we just have to trust God. Like he said, he says, we're entering the season of fire and tribulation. Walk with me. And though he's shown me that he was at my left hand, I was at his right hand, walking a narrow path, like a dirt walkway. And it was intentional where we were going. There was only one path we were following, and we were side by side, and he's counseling. And as he counsels, after he speaks this walk with me, he caused me to notice that at my right hand, I saw him again. And I was like, what? And there he is again. He's holding this hand, but there's a gap of a grassy area in between. And then on the other side of the grassy area, there's the Lord standing on another narrow path, heading in the exact same direction. And I leaned just enough to see, and he was walking at your left hand also. You were also at his right hand. And that was the point, him saying, he poured into my heart, like the whole, it goes with that thing he said, give him to me.
Right.
And so we don't have to worry about the journey of those at our side. Even parents, we have a way of hyper focusing on our children or our friends. Well, we pray for them and trust God.
Amen.
Only that it says Jesus taught that all who have been taught by the Father will know truth.
Right.
And the only way that we could actually know him, know Jesus or Yeshua, truly know him, truly trust him, would be that the Father himself draws us.
Right.
So that becomes our prayer. Father God, I trust you in this. You say you will watch after our children, and your word is true. I will not worry. I lift them up to you. And then literally do that. Just begin to give God thanks every night and every day. Don't continue to groan out the same prayer, but to give thanks for the work that God is doing. And like it says, I think it's in Corinthians, but I'm not positive about that, but I think it's in 1 Corinthians where it says to speak of things hoped for, not of things seen. And so we just begin, you know, if we take our eyes off of what our worries are, and just begin to give God thanks as if these good things were already happening, and then just watch to see them revealed and watch them happen.
Well, CJ, I thank you so much for those comments. I want to wrap this up and bring it back to Netanyahu.
Yeah, and I thank you for thanking me.
Because of the things of what you just said, of walking together.
Heading in the same direction.
Yes.
But each led by God.
God. Okay. With Netanyahu, let me ask you this. Would it make a difference to you in your thinking about what he would be doing and making these decisions that he's making if he publicly professed that he was a believer in Yeshua and he knows that Yeshua was his Savior?
Would it make a difference to me? I would have to say not really, because I would love for him to. I would love to hear those words. But I think that we could hear someone like the Pope or someone might profess that. But does the fruit show that? It's not my judgment. It's between he and the Lord. And, you know, something within the Spirit tells me that Netanyahu already belongs to the Lord.
He understands.
And so whether
without
I think
having
that
to
he
publicly
could be,
profess that to the, everyone in the world.
Right. The Bible does say, the Word of God does say that we must publicly profess. So there is a great like and not deny him. The fact if he were to deny him publicly, that would be a huge problem.
I'm sure it would be upfront news for sure.
Yeah, it would be a huge problem. But I think that's part of and we know that he has to have professed it to someone in order for the Lord to accept his truth. So that's between Netanyahu and his wife in the privacy of their bedroom could have professed to one another their faith and their trust in Yeshua as Messiah, coming Messiah King.
Right.
And, you know, so that each God sees the fullness of the walk. And he knows the whole story about every couple and every individual everywhere. And so it's not as important to me that I, with my own ears, hear him profess that, but that, if I were to hear him deny Yeshua as Lord and anticipate Yahweh's blessing, I would tremble.
Good point.
For him.
That good point. I'm glad you made that aspect of it. I can always count on you coming up with something I wasn't even thinking about.
Well, that's God in us.
I know.
You know, the Holy Spirit leading us. Thank you. I thank you for acknowledging the work that the Holy Spirit does.
Yes.
That's awesome.
Thank you.
And I feel the same. Like I don't, you know, we come together. We don't know what God is doing behind the scenes with the other, because God's leading us individually.
Okay. So I guess you got a pretty good idea of what Netanyahu, what he's up against, what prophecy is written about this area, this particular area. We also understand what God says about that he's making this happen to draw the world in so that he could have his final show you who he is.
Yeah. Could you repeat again, what was that Bible verse that you were using this morning? I think it was out of Old Testament, but
Joel 3,
okay.
2-12.
Joel, okay. Chapter 3, verses 2-12.
Right.
And when you're like that, it never hurts you to start with verse 1.
No, but because it starts out with, I will gather all nations.
Oh, that's perfect.
You see, that's how it starts, and that's how, where he's gathering them together.
Right.
And these things that are happening is prophecies that are being fulfilled. And these areas, these disputed areas, are coming about for a reason. And the ugliness that we see has to happen before the beauty comes.
Right.
So that's why those of us that are believers can receive what's happening without any strife.
Yeah. At least that is God's will, and we claim that.
Yes.
We speak it to be made manifest.
Amen.
No strife in your life. We don't need to judge one another or the world around us. Just make your own choices. Who will you walk with this day? And who will you trust? And so put your eyes on the Lord. Put your trust in the Lord. And if there's situations that cause you to plummet downhill, choices have to be made.
Yes.
You know, it's just the
reality.
Don't
be lukewarm.
Don't be lukewarm. Be bold and confident in your love and in your faith and in your trust. And knowing that God is your master, not the mammon of relationships.
Amen.
Earthly relationships. Because God says, think relationship, not routine. And that first relationship is with him. And then all the rest, like love God first and love one another like Yeshua loves the church. So he does want us to walk together. He does want us to work it out in love.
I love you.
And I love you too.
And we really appreciate you guys listening.
Yeah, we do. We surely do appreciate. That's a great way to put it. We love the fact that you love God.
Yes.
And that you want to be pleasing to him and walk with him, and we trust that's what's happening. And Thank you so much for joining us here this day on Jerusalem Broadcasting Texas, where we are reaching out by the hand in love, not because of who we are, but because in God's call, He's caused us to die to self and care about what He cares about more greatly than anything else.
Amen.
Amen.
In our home.
Woohoo! Love to all.